ignore his name specific. Request him that before we go to the different type of products, to please explain all the pipes, connections, walls, and then the butterfly walls. These things, if you can explain us in detail, that will be very good. I request Mr. Gupta to please explain the different types of connections and the walls.
See, in butterfly valve, we have two types of valves. One is a simple that you have a handle in the valve like this. If we don't see the top portion of this, we just see this. So there is a you know plate inside, and then there is a handle at the top, which is handle is being rotated and opened and closed to make the on-off position. And the same valve, we remove the handle, and then we just put this actuator. We call it actuator. If you see carefully, that there are two nuts, we remove these nuts and we can put the handle for manual control, or we can remove the handle and put this actuator, which is operated by means of air supply in this. If you see, there is a top, there is a hole, that is for air supply connection, and by using air supply that valve can be opened or closed. So butterfly valve can have manual as well as the actuated by air supply. So this is a one kind of butterfly valve. What
But where do we use the butterfly valve? Can you tell to
this? These butterfly valves we used in every application in the dairy industry. See, mainly we say that earlier days we used to have a plug valves. Nowadays this is more or less place is replaced by butterfly valves. But this is very it's maintenance free, and you can just use it in from the reception to the milk powder section. Lot of places, liquid milk line basically. They are using liquid milk line for CIP line, for all products application line, this butterfly valve is being used.
And now you can have handle also, and now with the actuator you are using
both.
Both you using.
So if there is air problem, some problem, then you can remove the actuator. It takes 2 minutes, and you can just put the handle and you can operate it. So there is no need to replace the total valve. Whereas in the plug valves, you have to remove the valve, put the kind of other things, you know. So this is the flexibility of this butterfly valve. That's the one thing. Then something like this, we have a check valve. This I maybe will try to open it.
Where do we use the check valve?
Check valve is being used where the in the line where we don't want that product to come back to the system, like in the balance in the milk pump, you know, at the discharge. If you put a check valve, the product which goes in to the top to the silo. And all the product, if there is no check valve, all the product will come down, drain from the pump out and go to the drain. So we want to save that, product, you know. So we put the check valve. So this check valve is, you can say, is a one-way valve, you can say in a simple language. So what happens, if you see at the top, there is a, maybe you can, there is a spring loaded. So there is a spring when the, if there is a big pressure, then only it operates. So that means if this is a pump, so pumps, there is a pump here, milk pump, at the discharge we put the check valve. By the pump pressure, this liquid will go in, comes out and go to the system, next system. And if there is no pump, this pump is stopped, then that product which in the line, all line or maybe 10-20 feet, it will stop, it will not come back. So it will only allow the product to go up, it will not allow to come in. So I'll just try to open this valve and try to show something in this. This is very simple. This is 3A standard valve, we call it. This is American standard valve, that means everything is openable. So this is a tri-clover clamp. and then this is the top cover, and if I reverse it, this is the bottom and this is that spring. So you can see that everything in this is
removable type,
dismantleable. You can clean it very easily, and you will see that no milk, if anything, anybody can open it and clean it properly and then again put it back. So that is the specialty of this check valve,
that it is, it will not allow the product to come back.
It will not allow product to come back in such a way that you can open it, clean it, and no bacterial problem, and it is absolutely neat and clean. So this is a very important component in a in a process, in fluid processing. It can withstand nitrile, or we call it NBR, and it can withstand a temperature of around 110 degree centigrade.
It's quite good.
Quite good.
And that is sufficient.
Sufficient.
We don't go beyond that temperature.
Yes, sir.
And usually the CIP temperatures are not exceeding 85, 90 degrees.
So 80, 85 is very easily taken care, but they take some extra margins.
Okay.
And up to 110. If there is some high temperature program, then we go for EPDM or we go for Viton, and a lot of things are there. But for
normal operations,
this
110 is sufficient margin.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. So this is the check valve, what we have shown. Then I will try to show this a CIP ball. This is a CIP ball, which is which plays very important role for any tank cleaning operation. This ball is mounted at the top of the tank, and then the CIP liquid. You know, CIP. Maybe you are aware that the caustic solution, acid solution, comes through this, and there's a big tank. And then there is a spray of the water all on the tank. You will see that there are holes all around. So that means this hole will cover the top portion of the tank when the spray takes place. So this hole, this product will spray like this. So the top portion of the tank is covered, sides, walls, and the bottom. So this covers all the tank from inside to clean the all inner surface of the tank. So this plays a very important role. Again, in CIP we have different types of CIP ball. This is a fixed type. In some CIP balls, this rotates. When the liquid pressure comes from the top, this rotates. Again, there are different types of cuts where you can have a proper cleaning of the tank. But in the normal general dairy practices, this is a normal CIP spray ball what we are using. The next we have is this this is a very important item, that in the any storage tank, if like let us for the explain purpose, this is a tank, this is the, you forget this, this is the storage tank, and the storage tank, we want to see the level of the milk. What happens at that storage tank, we have a connection here at the top like this, and we have a connection here at the bottom like this, and the gap in between, we can put a pipe of some hose pipe or glass in between these two gap. That means in this, you see there is a rubber which is a very soft. I will just try to open this. See, this is stainless steel portion and this is the rubber, and in the rubber we put the glass. And from the top like this glass comes, and then we can measure the
level of the
level of the product inside the tank. If this is the tank, then we can show it. And this is again, you will see the top portion of this is again openable type. You can again open it. You can open this. Now again, everything is fully dismantleable. You can open it, clean it. You can see that nothing is, everything is very easily openable, you know. This is the top portion we want to clean. This is the bottom portion. Again, if you see this, everything is openable, and you can see this is through. Inside, this is through. I think cameraman can help me. This is through. And same thing is from the top is openable, bottom also it is openable. And this is openable. So what purpose is that everything should be openable, cleanable, so that no milk particles remains in the device, whether it's a sampling device or any device, and equipment should be fully openable so that it can be properly cleaned. It can be properly cleaned and then bacterial growth can be avoided.
So Gupta, as an alternative to this level indicator, you can also provide the load cell option.
Yes, sir. That's a commonly
between,
used now.
Between the level indicator and the load cell option, which one is more accurate?
Between the load cell and the indicator.
Indicator.
Load cell is of course very accurate, and the level maybe you have some error of 10-15 liters,
okay.
But load cell is so accurate you have plus minus 1 liter.
Any other electronic option for this?
Then there is again for level indication, we have a level indicators.
Yeah.
Then by using pressure diaphragm.
We have sensors.
Sensors
can,
on the top.
Sensor,
beam.
Yeah.
You can see when there's a beam.
Yes.
A beam falls from the top. The level depends on the rays comes back.
Yes.
That we get a signal. Mm. And
it
then
can be indicated on the dial.
That, correct.
Digital indicator.
Mm. It's but it is a, in a normal people, you know, in a small scale level.
Yeah.
They avoid that. But they prefer to have a normal glass, but for a big MNCs, you know, big companies,
yeah,
they go for a
PLC
control system, they go for this kind of
this
a thing, what we are, is very correct, so very commonly being used, that kind of. Then what we, I wanted to show that this is the sampling device, what we talked for the, when we have a level as well as sampling device both, and if you only want to have a sampling, no level indication, then we have a single sampling device, we just put it mount to the tank, there is a socket tank at the bottom, and then we take the sample out from this place. Again this is same thing, so this is a single, it is only a sampling device just to take the samples out. Again you will see the same thing. Same thing, you will see this is through. This is through. And this is made from a single piece. There is no welding in this. This is made from a solid bar so that there is no chance of any cavities inside. As in the beginning, Dr. Saluja told that the product material is, should be selected and welded in such a way that there is no cavities or no holes are left in between. So you can see even this is openable. You can take out the spring, you can take out the, and you can take out this whole body.
So this is for taking the samples.
This is only for taking the sample. This what we put in all storage tanks, intermediate tanks, other tanks, you know. And it is so simple, it takes very short time to assemble it. Then next we wanted to show that this is a side glass. Again you will see that there are nut bolts all around. This is a sample piece, in fact this is not to be, this cannot be mounted, only in some skid mounted systems in for some collie application can be done, but for the indicating the milk whether it is passing through or not, again if we try to open this we will see that everything is openable, cleanable, and again you can keep back to the same position. This is the side glass we call it, and again you will see that the thickness of this side glass, it should be matching with the pipe thickness. If you see this thickness is around 1.5 mm here, and if when we weld it or when we do something, it goes with the, it should match with the pipe thickness. So we should specify when we buy this side glass or any fittings, like you will see in this T also, the thickness plays very important role. See, this is the thickness. This is a very good thickness. Normally, we don't get in India so good thickness. They always have 1.2, 1.3. Mm-hmm. They just try to and then
at best 1.5.
Best 1.5. So this is 1.6 mm thickness, and this is and then this should match with the pipe thickness what you are putting in the plant to avoid the any kind of a problems, you know. But and then otherwise there is a lot of difficulties in bacterial count. You are not able to get the full count. You do not able to trace the problem. Kahan aa raha hai, kahan, where is the problem? Where it is coming in? So you have to very very careful in selecting these fittings. This plays a very important role in a milk industry. So you have to select very carefully these kind of fittings what you have. Similarly, we have this bends. See, this is what I am trying to show is a short bend, you know. If you see this and see the finish, why people are using short bend? Because you can go up to, you can easily finish it. If you go for a long bend which is longer on both the sides, then it's difficult to finish from inside, then there's a lot of bacterial problems, you know. So again, one should try to use the short bends. We call it 90 degree bends, and one is the long bends. So this is should be commonly used in dairy industry. Then we have this kind of a reducers. If you want to change the line from higher diameter to lower diameter, so this is the reducers. This is some new type reducer has come in the market, and this is a eccentric reducer, what we call it. If you can see the difference, this is straight, and this you will see that it is
tapering
from one side, and from one side it is, so you can see. And this what it is, I think mentioned 1.5 inch by 1 inch. So this is 1.5 inch, and this is 1 inch. So if you have in the line of 1.5 inch, let's say this is the P, what we want to make it to one inch from this. So we just put it like this, or we put it like this. Our line is there for 1.5 inch. Milk is going through, and we want to take out some device. So we weld it like this, and then we argon arc welding.
Seamless.
Very, very correct. Seamless. So it should become in such a way that, see, this is very minor things, but for a dairy plant, it's a very, very important thing.
Matters a lot.
Otherwise, manager production is searching around where is the from where the bacterial count is coming, where is the problem. Then he has to check every connections, and then he takes care of that kind of a thing. So this is the thing. Then I have tried to show this this unions. You know, slide on the right hand side, you will see there are different types of union. One is SMS, then DIN. DIN is a German standard. Then IDF / ISO. IDF is International Dairy Federation, and ISO is International Standard Organization, and then we have a CLAN. So what in India what we are using is normally SMS type union. DIN is for some other special big plants where the some German equipments are arriving, then we have to put DIN union to matching with their equipment. But otherwise normal trend we are using SMS union. So this what I have shown here is SMS union. Again, this union has got a 3 parts, male, female, and then this nut. See, if you see this first portion, second portion, and in between this, there is a gasket. You see this? So, and then we have this nut. Like this. But only thing is that this union was in use for last many years.
Maybe you explain again what is nut, what is male part, and what is the joining wall by showing one by one.
Okay. So this is the liner. This is the liner where we have to weld the pipe from the one side. See, when we join any pipe length, if the we have to transfer milk from one place to another place, then we cannot have a single pipe, because pipe standard length is 20 feet. So we have to put in between a jointing system, so that we use by using a union or by using a this latest thing, tri-clamp. in union, what happens? We suppose, let us assume that this is the pipe coming from one side. We weld this like this, and from the other side we get another pipe, which is another. We weld again, same thing. We weld like this, and then this work as a jointer. So this V is a liner, and this is the nut, and this is the gasket in between, which makes sure that there is no leakage. And then this is the locking for both of them. But in this stage, the what happens that it's you have to use a tool. See, if you see, there is a cut here. This cut here. So one, while tightening, you have to put a lot of pressure to tighten that this and this portion, so that this is fully tight. So this is a bit laborious thing nowadays. So after now, people are changing to this tri clamp tie fittings. This I will show. This is very simple. You will see that simply open with one butterfly nut, and this is the ferrule. This is the one portion of it. This is a silicone gasket, or it could be NBR gasket, and this is another portion of the ferrule. So this you can just see, there is no just sub, and it is so simple. Just put it back and tighten. There is no need to use, this is hand tight, you know, this is hand tight, whereas in this union it was a tool tight. You have to use some kind of a key to tighten it. So people are adopting to this tricolor fittings. So these are the difference between the union and the tricolor fittings. Now the next thing comes to the, see, when you go for a long pipes of 10, 20, 30 feet, we try to hold the pipe, because otherwise this pipe can tilt. So we just put the, if let us assume that this is the pipe sort of a thing, then what happens, we just open it and then pipe is kept in between, and then it is tighten it. But in fact this is a bigger size, but something like this, you know. And again here, if you see this pipe, that fitting what we were talking is this. So this portion, I will just try to open it up. So this portion, that pipe is like this, and we put it like this. Maybe this can give you better one time. Lock it like this. See, now I think it's better now. So the pipe, any pipe which is going in, either we can put this tri clamp, or on the other side you can put then we don't need this connection, we need to have this union connection. So you will see that this is more difficult to open up than simple to open like this. So this what we have tried to cover up, this fittings, pipe and fittings. So this is a very important slide. See, if you see this, in this we have shown three categories. You see at the bottom 180 degree, 270 degree and 360 degree. This is what this CIP ball I was explaining you. In this again, that depends upon the level of cleaning. If we want to only clean the straight portion of the tank, then we use this 180 degree CIP ball. And if we want to go to the top, we don't want to clean the bottom, maybe the bottom is different type, then we use for 270 degree kind of a spray ball. And if we want to clean the full tank, then we go for a complete 360 degree spray nozzle. So that means all, even the holes all over around, this is, you can say, 360 degree spray ball. So this is a very important thing in the tank cleaning. If you see this slide, you will see that this is the valve arrangement in a tank garden for independent routing of products and cleaning of solutions to and from the tanks. In a big plants, there are a lot of tanks, and we want to use by using PLCs, that which tank to be emptied, what is your situation? Say all PLC control system that Dr. Dravid had just mentioned about that big projects, you know. So in that you will see that these are the header of the valves where we have a lot of connections from different tanks and controlled by PLC based system. So we product from the different tank. And on the bottom right hand side you will see that examples of a standard pipe support, that's what I was trying to explain. So this is the standard pipe support, how to hold a long pipe, you know. And at the bottom you will see there is a cubical, there is a rectangular square pipe. Again this is stainless steel pipe where these clamps are welded, and then over that there is a pipe is being put in. So this completes the pipe and support section. Butter is very commonly used in our industry, manufactured, and everybody is using in the life. So butter is being manufactured mainly by using a butter churn, you know. And what is butter churn? Butter churn is a simple cylindrical, conical disc and top shaped container, and that container is being it has got a slow revolutions which change direction of the rotation, and then there is a water is being sprayed over that butter churn, and then we have a guard rail to protect, because this when this big drum is rotated at a some RPM, so we want to make sure that the people who are working around this is protected. See this slide, it is shown here that we have a three types of butter churn. The first one is that top shaped churn, and then second one on the right hand side is a disc shaped churn, and third is a cylindrical shaped churn. In the in a normal small factories people use cylindrical shaped churn, and still large factory they use disc shaped churn, whereas in the big companies where the milk is handling is 2 lakh 3 lakh liters per day, they use this top shaped churn, butter churn. And in this first picture you will see that there is a guard shown which is spraying the water to maintain the temperature of the butter churn. On the right side there is a drive and cream inlet and butter outlet door is shown in the front. So this is being used in the big dairy factory. Then this is a batch method. What we talked about is the batch method of making butter. Then nowadays because of the large production in some factories, we have to go for a continuous butter making machine, and we call it CBMT. We call it CBMT, continuous butter making machine. In continuous butter making machine, what happens is that at the back there is a drive, and the cream is fed from the top, and there is a churning cylinder, and that pumps the cream in, and there is a auger at the bottom, and there is a salt dosing device at the bottom, again from the bottom, and this keeps on rotating, and working and washing takes place in this, and we get the from the top right side we get the butter, ready butter from outlet of this continuous baking machine. The next slide we have tried to show the both. On the left hand side if you see there is a drum butter churn for batch production, just to give an idea we have already discussed. And at the bottom there is a butter trolley, also drum churn at the bottom, this is a butter trolley. And then we have a general process batch and continuous production of butter. If you will see at the top it is showing the butter churn, it is on the this drawing with the two options. If you see in the this 9, this one is the batch one, this one is the batch one which is showing number 9 as a butter churn what we have discussed, and number 10 as a continuous butter making machine. So this you will see that cream is processed and that enters the butter churn number 10, and then we get the butter out, and that will be being collected and then packed for purpose application for the process. The next slide you will see that butter is so hard that again it is difficult to pump, you know. So what in recent in the people are doing it, that they are collecting the butter in a butter trolley, big trolley which is having a auger system at the bottom, and at the outlet if you will see there is a low pump. We have discussed in earlier this thing, lobe pump. So this is a lobe, there are two lobes in this, and that butter from inside the tank it comes throughout auger with some pressure, and that goes in the lobe, and that lobe butter touch gets in, and you can throw this butter out to your different sections. So it is just like a milk pump, you know, but it's a lobe pump. So this is a very commonly things adopted recently in big plants, because this save a lot of manpower and process becomes faster. Then we go to cheese. So cheese is basically consist of manufacturing of cheese consist of cheese vat. Then we should have knife, then curd mill, hoops and press. So here we are trying to show this a basic cheese vessel. On the left hand side it is vat with agitator, and on the right hand side it is jacketed vat and showing a small hoop. If you want to go for a this jacketed vat is normally used for the small scale production, and the vat with agitator is for the faster production. And still, if you want to go for a very fast production, then we have another slide showing here conventional cheese vat with the tools for cheese manufacture. In one vat, you can have a shearing device, you can have a cutting device, you can have a drainage, and then the vat during pressing, everything in one vat. So we have different attachments. If you see at the bottom, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9, these are different attachments put in the one cheese vat, and you can produce the cheese at the fastest way possible in the industry. Then again, this is the what we were talking about was the normal cheese. Then we talk of the processed cheese. Processed cheese is made by further processing of finished cheese, usually a blend of hard rennet varieties with different aromas and degree of maturity. In processed cheese, it is a very expensive method to manufacture processed cheese. So we use a cheese cooker. Here you will see that cooker for processed cheese. This is a very very expensive equipment, and this is made under with a very thick material. It's all 316, and this is the tilting type. You know, if you will see the first left hand side move slide, so this is a cheese cooker, and the right hand side you will see that it's open and tilted position. So once the cheese is made, you can just tilt by means of this handle, and you can take out the product and you can clean it and then empty it the product. So this processed cheese, this is the main equipment being used in the processed cheese. So now we come to ice cream. Shall we cover up ice cream? Ice cream is again a very common product for Indian market. That again in ice cream we have two types of freezers. One is a batch freezer and another is a continuous ice cream freezer. Batch freezer will be shown, hand operated freezer, yes, it is shown here. There is a handle and there is a conical shape small vessel, and there is a, in between there is a agitator kind of a thing, which we call it a dasher, which we call it a dasher, and then a mix, and then it's rotated with the hand, and then you basically in ice cream you have to build up the overrun, you know. So by mixing it, we do it by manual method, and then we have the same thing in the, it is bit shown the scraper refrigeration chamber, and then the discharge. So this is the batch again, second slide. In third slide it is shown scraper and a freezer body, that how the scraping and rotation takes place in the freezer body, so that no ice cream is being, it is moving all around, so that the temperature of the all the ice cream product is maintained in a proper way. Then we have a continuous ice cream freezer. That's what it is. It's better to go to next slide where we can show you the real look of the ice cream freezer. If you see on the left hand side, there are two freezers shown. This is the different models, and on the in between there is a dasher which plays very important role in the ice cream freezer. And on the right hand side, you will see that on the black thing which is slightly tilted, this is a most important thing in the ice cream freezer. Earlier time, this is cylinder of the for making ice cream. Earlier time, this used to be the straight horizontal. Some people in the world may develop these freezers with the vertical 90 degree vertical what we call it a system. And but this one Italian company, they have developed this with a 45 degree inclined this system, so that you can have the best temperature of the ice cream from coming out. Because if you have a fully horizontal, then maybe you need a lot of space to go for a higher capacity. Vertical, if you have vertical cylinder, then there is a problem of handling, workers operation problems come. So they have decided and they have seen that if you go for a 45 degree inclined this device, then you can have the best temperatures, and the overall if you see everything will be the best kind optimum optimization they have done like this. Then in the pasteurized in ice cream processing plant, we have again two types of processing plants. One is the batch pasteurization and another one is the continuous STST pasteurization. In the batch pasteurization plant, you will see that there are two tanks. There are two tanks, and then we have a on the right hand side homogenizer, and on the this right hand there is a control panel, and here is the heater, the left side. First one is the heater. So just we produce the hot water and that goes to the pasteurization. It's a, what we have talked earlier of LTLT, low temperature, long time. So this is the by providing the hot water in the jacketing, and we pasteurize the mix, homogenize the mix, and send it to the aging vats, and for the freezer. The next slide we have of the continuous STST. It is showing a continuous STST pasteurization plant in which there is no batch pasteurization but only a mixed pasteurization plant, which is again in two sections or three sections. So you will see that the first two tanks are kind of a aging tank, and then the right one plated oxygenator is shown on the right hand side, and there is a homogenizer just next to left hand side to this is the homogenizer, and so this is a continuous process to produce the mix. And after mix is being produced, pasteurized from this process, it goes to the freezers, continuous freezers where we have discussed earlier. So ice cream process is the pasteurization and the it goes to the freezer. Then next in general we have tried to show here that ice cream machines to produce chocolate coating machines and bar coating machines. Again these machines are 5000 pieces per hour for the chocolate dipping. See what happens, the ice cream comes from the back, the discs and that the sticks are inserted automatically, and then there is a chocolate tank at the bottom. So the movement is such a way that the ice cream with the stick is dipped in this chocolate tank for such a time that the layer of the chocolate is not overcoated than the requirement. So the RPM of the movement of the conveyor is moving such a way that you get the coated proper thickness of the chocolate coating on the ice cream. So this is we complete with this ice cream section also. Now let us see the.
Now I will request Dr. Dravid, who had been a long experience in the dairy, and he is also the coordinator. So maybe he can add some important information to the presentation, particularly from the dairy equipment side and from our learners' point of view, sir. Please.
Pasteurize is the most important unit operation in the dairy sector. Here, the plates which were shown by Mr. Gupta, those plates have undergone a sea change. And that change is the overall heat transfer coefficient has been increased by reducing the thickness of the plates. Earlier, the overall heat transfer coefficient used to be of the order of not more than 800 kilocalories per square centimeter. Today's pasteurizers are having an overall heat transfer coefficient of around up to 3000. So that is the change which has undergone in the pasteurizer. Earlier the pasteurizers were being purchased on the price on that day, but today the overall utilities consumed are more important. That is one. Secondly, the holding tubes which are outside, these holding tubes should be subjected to the efficiency, whether 15 seconds holding time is being observed or not. That can be done by two methods, electrical conductivity and by dye injection method. These two methods are available which can be used for finding the efficient holding time. The plates can be loosened easily. He told us about the system by which the plates can be loosened, because from season to season you need not open the pasteurizer completely, you can loosen the plates and scrub the plates, reassemble. The other thing which is important is the pressure drop which is taking place after the duplex filters. When should you change the filters? That is important. Then in the pasteurizer plates it is important that the pressure on the milk side is always higher than the pressure on the heating or the cooling medium side. Then another thing he explained to us was about the pneumatic valves. The pneumatic valves are very important, and the pneumatic valve will function properly only when the compressed air is having the lowest dew point. And for that, proper system should be installed for dehumidification. That is very important. Then the third, then the sampling thing which he has told is also very important, which can be installed in places where you want to control the standardization of milk, where you want to control the heating temperatures, where you want to control the flow rates. So some very salient points have to be studied. And dairy engineering is a multidisciplinary subject: civil, mechanical, electrical, chemical, instrumentation, electronics, and computer. All the engineering fields are being covered under dairy engineering. So a dairy engineer is a very talented fellow, is a very important fellow for the dairy sector, who gives you a mix of all the engineering in one. That is what I have to say. I wish I had little more time. I could have talked at length. Anyway, thank you for giving me the opportunity and talking to you people. It is nice, and I hope that every dairy engineering subject should be studied in a very creative way, and how you can apply the engineering for various applications to get the best product. And in the subsequent sessions, when we are talking of ISO and HACCP in 21st century, globalization, then the engineering constitutes a very important aspect which controls various parameters. And I am sure the IGNO program that is being offered will be made use of in the best possible manner. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Dravid sir, and thank you, Mr. Gupta, for me.
Thank you.
Thank you to the viewers. Thank you, please.